Hey team, so if you've been on TikTok recently, you might have heard this song. I'll dance, dance, dance with my hands, hands, hands above my head, 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 like Jesus said. It's called Bloody Mary, and it's from Lady Gaga's second album, Born This Way. It blew up on TikTok because people were putting the song over their fan edits of Wednesday Addams from the new Netflix show Wednesday while she's dancing, and then they were dancing to it themselves. And TikTok did what TikTok does by ruining the song by putting the high-pitch filter over it. And everyone fell in love with it anyways because it's just that good of a song. It blew up so much that it actually prompted Lady Gaga to release it as the sixth single from the album, 11 years after it was initially released. Okay, TikTok, do Donatella from Art Pop next. Come on, let's go! Now, one thing about me is I'm not gonna gatekeep. If a deep cut blows up a decade after its initial release, I'm not gonna say that the general public doesn't deserve to enjoy it just because they slept on it for too long. But I will take the opportunity to let everyone know that I did, in fact, like the song before it was cool. And I have proof. It was my 20th most streamed song of last year. All I'm saying is if you wanna be ahead of the pop culture curve, you could do worse than listening to me. And subscribing, you should subscribe. So, the song is perfect, that goes without saying, but what is it about? Bloody Mary usually refers to Queen Mary the First, who ruled over England and Ireland in the 1550s, but it's pretty clear that Gaga is actually referring to the biblical and historical figure Mary Magdalene. The song is from the perspective of Mary Magdalene and is addressed to Jesus. On a surface level, it tells the story of Mary's emotional journey during Jesus's crucifixion. But any kind of modern application of the message of the song is elusive. It's hard to interpret. Even Stephen Roberts, a professor of theology, philosophy, and religion, admits as much in his essay, Beyond the Classic: Lady Gaga and Theology in the Wild Public Sphere. He writes, "Gaga's positive theological vision is developed in songs about two figures that carry marginal associations in Christian tradition. Bloody Mary is hard to interpret, but her typically strange confession of belief that Mary Magdalene was both fully divine and fully human suggests a transgression of the dominant theological tradition of Christianity, which is continued in Judas, the most theological track on the album." And that is all he wrote about Bloody Mary in the essay. The songs he spends the most time discussing are Born This Way, Judas, and Edge of Glory, presumably because they're three of her most popular songs. They are all singles, after all. But Bloody Mary is a single now, too. And I'm convinced that she isn't just telling a story, but is saying something theologically important because of the album it appears on. I also think the song is best interpreted in the context of the theology of the rest of the album and Lady Gaga herself. See, Lady Gaga is a theologian. I mean, like, actually, Lady Gaga's a theologian. And she's probably one of the most influential alive today. And she really cemented herself as one in 2011 with the release of Born This Way, which is stuffed full of not just religious imagery, but explicitly theological assertions. In my opinion, Gaga's religious convictions are something that don't get talked about enough, especially considering how often they come up in her music. As writer Guthrie Gray Fitzsimmons said in his opinion piece, The Provocative Faith of Lady Gaga, published in the Washington Post in 2017, some conservative Christians reject her as heretical. The dancing alone is enough to damn her. The secular left doesn't know what to make of religious progressives, so they largely ignore her Christian identity. But what then do we make of Lady Gaga? The result is that her strong religious and progressive convictions get ignored. He then references Gaga's 2016 hit Million Reasons as he continues, Lady Gaga's faith is not a trend, and it's not something that can be ignored. When was the last time you heard a call to prayer and to seek the Lord on top 40 radio? And I agree, but most conservative Christians today are content rejecting her claims of faith and denying her Christian identity, if not outright condemning her as a devil worshiper. But she does explicitly identify as Christian, and she's not shy about this. One of the more publicized moments in which she identified her faith happened at a concert in Vegas in 2019, when she said,
And to Mike Pence, who thinks it's acceptable that his wife work at a school that bans LGBTQ, you are wrong. You say we should not discriminate against Christianity. You are the worst representation of what it means to be a Christian. And what I do know about Christianity is that we bear no prejudice and everybody is welcome.
In the aftermath of this event, a YouTube channel called WWUTT released the video, "Is Lady Gaga a Christian?" That does a beautiful job summarizing the average conservative Christian's opinion of Lady Gaga in 90 seconds.
So Lady Gaga says she's a Christian. Let's ignore that she's hardly ever dressed, she blasphemes God, and her music and videos are raunchy. Setting that aside, please, Lady Gaga does not meet her own standard of Christianity. She said, "We bear no prejudice and everybody is welcome. Except for Mike Pence, his wife, and everyone who believes as they do, right?"
Of course, he chooses to ignore what Lady Gaga actually said to make this point, because what she didn't say is, "Mike Pence is not a Christian." She never said, "Mike Pence isn't welcome." What she said was that he's the worst example of what it means to be a Christian. But the man who created this video, Pastor Gabe, has no problem gatekeeping his religion. In a follow-up video on a second channel, Pastor Gabe clarifies that, yes, he is in fact totally comfortable claiming that Lady Gaga is not a real Christian.
I think it is pretty evident we can look at the life of Lady Gaga and know she is not saved.
That's weird. You're being weird. The follow-up video is called "Responding to Lady Gaga's Claim That She's a Christian," and in it he responds to several comments that he received on that original video. In this video, he admits that the reason he's even spending time talking about Lady Gaga is because she's very influential, and goes on to give his perspective on the song Born This Way.
When it comes down to it, Lady Gaga is very influential, and you know that. One of the most popular songs in her repertoire is a song that she did back in 2011 called Born This Way. And this is one of the most blasphemous pop songs that I have ever heard. Just consider some of the lyrics of this song. "There's nothing wrong with loving who you are," she said, "'cause he made you perfect, babe." No, you are not perfect. In fact, Romans 3:23 tells us that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. The chorus says, "I'm beautiful in my way, 'cause God makes no mistakes. I'm on the right track, baby. I was born this way." Well, it's true that God makes no mistakes, but you make plenty, and it's called sin.
The condescension in his voice is too powerful. This frustrates me because it's like, can you think of a less charitable way to interpret these lyrics? Elsewhere in the song, Gaga sings, "You're black, white, beige, Chola descent. You're Lebanese, you're Orient. Whether life's disabilities left you outcast, but leader tease." Clearly, this song is not about loving your sin. The song is not saying that people don't make mistakes. It's about loving the parts of you that you don't choose. But Pastor Gabe doesn't see that for some reason.
Lady Gaga has a tremendous gift. She is an incredible singer and has quite a talent indeed, but she doesn't use that talent to glorify God. Instead, she uses that talent to tell people that they can live in whatever sinfulness they want because God made them that way.
So where does Pastor Gabe get this idea that the song is actually about celebrating and rejoicing in your sin? Hopefully not from the lyrics about race and disability. No, if you've heard the song, I'm sure you can guess where his real beef is.
She goes on to say, "A different lover is not a sin. Believe, capital H-I-M. Unbelievable. So if you live in sexual immorality, according to Lady Gaga in this song, in just two lines of the second verse, well, you're not sinning. You just need to believe in capital H-I-M because God made you this way. And so you should live however you want to live." She is leading people straight to hell with this nonsense. Later on in the song, she says, "No matter gay, straight, or bi, lesbian, transgendered, life, I'm on the right track, baby. I was born to survive." You will not find truth and life in the music of Lady Gaga. It will only lead to sin and death.
It's unclear from this video whether Pastor Gabe believes the classic being gay is a sinful choice, or if he believes the more progressive, attraction isn't a choice, but acting on it is sinful. Either way, his interpretation of this song as endorsing sinfulness hinges on his belief that homosexuality and gender transition are sinful choices. What he has to ignore is the structural and musical parallel between the breakdown about race and disability and the breakdown about sexuality and gender identity. Both parts have the same melody and rhythm. What she's doing here in comparing the two is saying, sexuality and gender identity, like ethnicity, is not something that you choose. That's also why it's called Born This Way. You don't choose the way you're born. Because his worldview tells him that homosexuality is always a sinful choice, he has to interpret the rest of the song in that light, and comes out the other end with a wildly inaccurate claim that the song is about celebrating sinful choices, when it's quite clearly a song about celebrating the parts of you that you don't choose. Pastor Gabe's totally inaccurate interpretation of the song comes from his inability to interpret the song on its own terms. In his book, Understanding Theology and Popular Culture, religious studies professor Gordon Lynch really emphasizes the importance of understanding pop culture on its own terms. He writes, "A serious theological study of popular culture demands sufficient ethical patience to understand popular culture on its own terms before subjecting it to critical scrutiny in relation to our understanding of the absolute. Judging popular culture on the basis of our own preformed religious and cultural assumptions, without allowing the possibility for these to be challenged or changed in some way by our study of popular culture, will not help us to become better cultural critics or more thoughtful theologians." But Gaga's terms are, homosexuality is not inherently sinful, and that's ground that Pastor Gabe won't even hypothetically concede for the sake of understanding what the song really means. I also think that Pastor Gabe's interpretation of Born This Way is a perfect example of one of four different ways that a dialogue between theological tradition and popular culture might be conducted, that Lynch outlines in his book. The first approach he calls an applicationist approach. He writes, "In this approach, popular culture is subjected to a critique on the basis of certain fixed theological beliefs and values. Having identified these beliefs and values, popular culture is then evaluated positively or negatively to the extent that it fits with this particular religious view of the world." I think it's pretty clear that Pastor Gabe uses an applicationist approach when dealing with popular culture, but I also think he does it pretty poorly. For example, he says,
"The song goes on, don't hide yourself in regret, just love yourself and your set. I bet she grew up on Disney movies. I'm on the right track, baby. I was born this way." Well, in 2 Corinthians, the Apostle Paul tells us that there is a kind of regret that leads to godliness. Lady Gaga has said, you don't need to experience regret at all.
No, that's way too many syllables. The line is actually, don't hide yourself in regret. In the video, Pastor Gabe goes on to give two examples of different kinds of regret. He says that the biblical figure Peter experiences the good kind of regret, which leads him to repent after denying Jesus 3 times. And Judas experiences the bad kind of regret, which led him to commit suicide after betraying Jesus. But if you ask me, Judas was the one hiding in regret, and Peter was the one who took Gaga's advice, and the biblical Peter, listen to Lady Gaga. Peter was the one who took Gaga's advice and loved himself enough to allow himself to grow and repent. Okay, here's another example of Pastor Gabe's messy applicationist approach to Gaga's music.
Lady Gaga goes on, still verse 2, "In the religion of the insecure, I must be myself, respect my youth." Well, incidentally, 2 Timothy 2:22 says to flee youthful passions and instead to pursue righteousness. So there is no respecting your youth. In fact, we need to stay away from those youthful passions and grow up.
So I have a Bible too. I can do this as well. Incidentally, in Matthew 18:3-4, Jesus says, "Truly I tell you, unless you change and become like little children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Therefore, whoever takes the lowly position of this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven." So Gaga's right. You should absolutely respect your youth. What these two examples tell me is that Pastor Gabe isn't actually interested in critiquing Born This Way based on fixed theological beliefs and values. Instead, he decided that Born This Way is a bad song with a bad message because of one of his beliefs, specifically the gay stuff, and then went searching for Bible verses to support his argument that the whole song is bad. That's why I'm wary of the applicationist approach, because so often it devolves into just using scripture as a weapon to silence any opposition to the religious tradition in question. So what are the other methods? Lynch goes on to summarize the four different methods as follows. The applicationist approach proceeds from the basis of a preformed theological agenda and set of beliefs, and listens to the voice of popular culture simply with the intention of evaluating the extent to which it fits this agenda or those beliefs. A correlational approach, by contrast, attempts to listen to popular culture to discern the primary struggles and concerns of contemporary society. It then seeks to analyze what religious tradition might have to offer by way of answers to these concerns, and to present these religious answers in ways that are intelligible and relevant to that contemporary context. A revised correlational approach values a complex conversation between the questions and insights of both religious tradition and popular culture, and allows for the possibility that both religious tradition and popular culture can be usefully challenged and transformed through this process. Finally, the praxis model seeks to evaluate both theology and popular culture on the basis of their capacity to promote life and practices that promote liberation and well-being. Lynch goes on to say, "In my view, the revised correlational approach is a constructive one precisely because it recognizes that truth and goodness are not the sole possession of one particular religious tradition or worldview." And I agree, which is why for the rest of this video, I'm going to try and use the revised correlational approach when discussing Gaga's music and its theology. That is to say, I will try to understand Gaga's music on its own terms, I will try to understand the religion she's singing about on its own terms, and then I will bring the two together in a mutually critical conversation. Lynch includes a visual model of what this process looks like in his book that looks like this. What does this look like in practice? Well, I'm going to be discussing all of Born This Way, the album, in this video. Disclaimer, when I'm talking about the album in this video, I'm talking about the special edition. I view it as the definitive edition because it includes the three bonus tracks, Black Jesus Cross, Amen Fashion, Fashion of His Love, and The Queen. But since we've already spent so much time discussing it, let's start with the title track. Track 2. So we start with a description of popular culture. In Born This Way, Gaga makes the theological assertion that homosexuality is not sinful. Because sexual orientation and gender identity are inherent characteristics that can't and don't need to be changed and should be celebrated instead. Then we move on to identifying relevant questions and norms in the religious tradition. The Christian tradition has historically said that same-sex relationships are inherently sinful. In recent history, this claim has been supported by 7 specific passages found in Scripture. 2 in the book of Genesis, 2 in the book of Leviticus, 1 in 1 Corinthians, 1 in 1 Timothy, and 1 in Romans. I don't have time to get into all the details in this video, but more and more Christians today are coming to an understanding of Scripture that does not condemn all loving same-sex relationships. And much of it comes from an understanding of what Lady Gaga is singing about. We're coming to realize that Scripture, in the original language at least, never speaks about loving same-sex relationships or sexual orientation in the way that we understand it today. This is a conversation that Pastor Gabe doesn't seem interested in having. He doesn't even try to provide any evidence that Gaga's wrong when she sings about queer acceptance. He just assumes that his audience will already agree with him. But when we look at the State of Theology survey results that came out this year, we see that 28% of evangelicals either agree or strongly agree that the Bible's condemnation of homosexual behavior doesn't apply today. That's up from previous years. I'm not saying that if more people believe it, that makes it true. I'm saying that this mutually critical conversation between pop culture and religious tradition is happening and is going to continue happening at an increasing rate, whether people like Pastor Gabe like it or not. Look at 1946, The Mistranslation That Shifted a Culture, a documentary that debuted this year. It's all about the decision in 1946 to add the word homosexual to the Bible for the first time in any language. This is all not to mention that studies as recently as 2020 have found that nearly half of all LGBTQ adults are religious, many identifying as Christians. We can act like Pastor Gabe and shut down the conversation before it's begun, or we can listen to what people like Lady Gaga have to tell us and really understand it before deciding how we're going to incorporate that information into our own worldview. At the end of the day, I've got to agree with Lady Gaga on this one. Theology needs reform here, and it's urgent. Not just because it's wrong, but keeping the praxis model in mind because of the demonstrable harm it's doing to queer youth growing up in unhealthy religious environments. In the meantime, with this song, Gaga has given those kids a space to love the parts of themselves that others hate. As we turn to Born This Way, the album, I think it's important to keep in mind that while all the individual songs have their own meaning, they're also individual parts to a larger whole. Interpreting individual songs in the context of other songs in the album and the album as a whole can be incredibly beneficial. For example, let's look at track 9. This song starts with Gaga chanting, black, 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 Jesus is the New Black. I interpret this song to be about Gaga finding new ways to understand and express her faith as she encounters, appreciates, and explores what many Christians might call secular cultures, such as high fashion and the type of music she's making. Saying something is the New Black means it's in style, it's fashionable, it's popular. But it's not always used to describe a trend. Sometimes it's used to try and dictate one. Gaga seems to be using the song not necessarily to reflect, but to shape the attitudes and beliefs of her audience. She's telling her audience, it's cool to like Jesus the way I do. She's not saying to follow the trend that is modern Christianity. She's trying to start a new Jesus trend. Looking at this song alone, that's all we can really get from it. But looking at the album as a whole, we can see more of what Gaga wants this new Jesus trend to look like. We learn from Born This Way that it's accepting of people no matter their race, ethnicity, disability, sexual orientation, or gender identity. We learn a similar lesson from track 5. This song is about Gaga falling in love with a woman in California. We fell in love, but not in court. Not in court here refers to the fact that gay marriage was not legalized in California until 2013, 2 years after Born This Way came out, since it had been constitutionally banned in 2008. In the chorus, she says, a sloppy applicationist reading of this song might be Lady Gaga is telling us not to participate in Christianity, not to listen to Christians, to reject Jesus Christ. Understanding this song on its own terms, though, those terms in part being set by the context of the rest of the album, we learn that what she's really articulating is a total rejection of the use of Jesus' name to promote bigotry and hatred against queer people. These are all ways that she wants to move away from traditional Christianity, but she also cleverly articulates the parts of the Christian tradition that she does still hold dear and absolutely does want to continue on with. My favorite comes in the bridge of the opening track, Marry the Night, in which she sings, love is the new, denim or black. Now, I only took 1 year of formal logic all the way back in 8th grade, but I'm pretty sure if love is the new black and Jesus is the new black, then according to the transitive property, which says that if A equals B and B equals C, then A equals C, that what Gaga's saying is that Jesus is love. And 1 John 4:16 says, God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them. God is love is a strong Christian sentiment that Gaga affirms, but she doesn't just give it to you. You kind of have to work for it, which, in my opinion, is part of what makes it such great art. I understand that there's this assumption that pop music tends to be shallow and vapid, and Lady Gaga specifically is a good example of this because she sings about fame, money, and sex. So I thought about starting this video with a defense of pop music and a defense of Lady Gaga like Roberts does in the essay I mentioned earlier. Instead, I decided to jump right in and try and show you instead of telling you. So after that example, I hope you understand two things. One, that Lady Gaga does not write shallow, vapid songs. Wait. No, she did write shallow. But anyways, one, Lady Gaga does not write shallow, vapid songs, but rich texts absolutely worth studying. And two, that interpreting these songs in the context of the album that they're in is essential to fully understanding their meaning. With that in mind, I think we can tackle what Roberts calls the most theological track on the album. Track 4. Judas, 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 Gaga. If there's one Lady Gaga song that's been written about more than any other, I would have to guess it's Judas. In the chorus, Gaga sings, and the breakdown and bridge culminate in the line, Jesus is my virtue, and Judas is the demon I cling to. The lazy applicationist view would say, in love with Judas, but Judas is evil. Gaga wants us to love evil? Lady Gaga worships Satan, confirmed. Of course, it should be obvious that the line, Jesus is my virtue, but Judas is the demon I cling to, suggests that something more is going on beyond just the blanket acceptance of all evil. It's not hard to read the song as a description of the struggle of wanting to choose virtue, but succumbing to temptation and choosing evil anyways. As Roberts points out, I think even this reading of the song is superficial. He writes, a first, I suggest superficial, reading of this is an expression of the tension between the good I want and the evil I do not want, that Paul describes in Romans 7. There is, however, none of Paul's regret played out in the song. Instead, it seems to be a rejection of the binary opposition of good and evil on the basis of which Christian tradition condemns Judas as the embodiment of sinfulness. He then mentions the Judas music video, which depicts Jesus and his disciples as bikers and Gaga as Mary Magdalene. Gaga places herself in the story as a sort of accessory to Judas in his betrayal of Jesus. But in the end, it's not Judas, but Gaga who's punished, being stoned for her actions. About his interpretation that Judas is about the rejection of the good and evil binary, Roberts writes, "This makes sense of the stoning at the end of the video, of Gaga as Mary Magdalene, here conflated with the woman caught in adultery in John 8. Jesus, of course, let the woman go free, but Christianity has been quick to judge and often today appears eager to condemn those falling outside a narrow vision of purity and goodness. This is the theological language of Jesus Christo that Gaga does not and will not speak. Instead, Judas offers a more inclusive theological vision that embraces rather than suppresses the shadow side that Judas represents." This reading also makes sense of the first verse of the song. In the biblical story in Matthew 7, a woman sinner washes Jesus' feet with her hair. Some have argued that this woman is actually Mary Magdalene. Gaga flips this, so she's the sinning woman washing the feet of Judas instead of Jesus. But in the next two lines, she attributes the betrayal of lying three times to Judas, when, as I already mentioned, it was Peter who denied Jesus three times, not Judas. And Jesus forgives him. But in this song, it's Gaga who forgives Judas for lying three times about her. But the blurring of these two characters, Judas and Peter, is almost certainly not accidental. Gaga grew up Catholic and she went to a Catholic high school. This is not a detail that someone with that background accidentally gets wrong. So the blurring of these two biblical characters might give us a hint as to what a more inclusive theological vision that embraces the shadow side actually looks like. Both Judas and Peter betrayed Jesus, but they also both followed him for years. They both have that shadow side, yet history remembers one as essentially good and the other as essentially evil. Perhaps Gaga conflates the two characters because she wants to emphasize the importance of forgiveness over the condemnation of the individuals in whom the evil manifests. An extra complication here, Gaga's attraction to Judas is understood to be negative, yet it's that attraction that seems to motivate her to forgive him. If she wasn't drawn to him against her will, would she have that desire to forgive him? This idea of the rejection of the good and evil binary is also featured heavily in track 10. If the superficial reading of Judas was an expression of the tension between the good I want and the evil I don't want, then the superficial reading of Bad Kids is an expression of the tension between how other people see me, bad, and what I really am like in my heart, good. It's easy to arrive at this understanding of the song from the chorus. So, according to this superficial reading, the bad kid is the person that your parents, for example, understand you to be. But Gaga is saying that she sees that you're not really a bad kid because she sees the purity in your heart. But this interpretation doesn't really make sense of the verses. According to the verses, here are all the things that Lady Gaga is. I'm a brat, I'm a loser, I'm a jerk, I'm a brat, I'm a selfish punk, I'm a twit, my parents got divorced cause I ruined their life. Degenerate young rebel and I'm proud of it. I'm a nerd, I'm absurd, I'm so bad, I don't give a damn, I love it when you're mad. Just like little tiny clips.
Am I sweating through my shirt yet?
She's not pushing back against the accusations of badness, she's leaning into them. And when she switches from singing about herself to singing to her fans, she reaffirms their badness, despite the purity in their hearts. She isn't saying, I know you're not really a bad kid because you have a pure heart. She's saying, I know you're a bad kid with a pure heart. The two are not mutually exclusive. In other words, like Judas, Bad Kids offers a more inclusive theological vision that embraces rather than suppresses the shadow side. I could leave it at that, but please allow me to indulge myself in a queer reading of this song. There's no explicit queer references in the song, but I think it would still be useful for a couple of reasons. The first and lesser reason is because that there was a fan rumor that the original lyrics replaced the words bad kid in the chorus with the F slur. even though I personally would have loved this version of the song, if true, I definitely think it was a good idea that she changed it. The second reason I think a queer reading of this song would be useful, it has to do with Gaga's audience. In Understanding Theology and Popular Culture, Lynch outlines three approaches to understanding popular culture. An author-focused approach, a text-based approach, and an ethnographic slash audience reception approach. Up until this point, I've mostly been using the text-based approach. I've largely focused on the meaning of the content of the lyrics without much reference to Gaga's personal life, background, or intentions. Lynch identifies this type of study as beneficial because the author of a popular cultural text may not have intended or indeed been conscious of all the meanings that are constructed by their text. On the other hand, an author-based approach can use context such as the background, status, personality, and intentions of a particular author to help construct meaning. Like how I mentioned her upbringing as a Catholic when discussing the blurring of the biblical characters of Peter and Judas to point out that it likely wasn't unintentional. But the third approach, an audience reception approach, highlights the creative power that audiences of popular culture have in constructing meaning. They're not just consumers, but creators as well. For example, the audience of the show Wednesday liked Jenna Ortega's dancing scene, but they weren't just passive consumers. They created their own meaning by choosing a different, better song to put in the background. They also created meaning by doing the dance themselves. Using an audience reception-based approach is especially appropriate for the song Bad Kids because the chorus of the song is sung in second person. Gaga addresses her listeners directly. So we have to ask ourselves, what type of people are listening to Bad Kids? It's not a single, it's a deep cut that mostly gets listened to by diehard Gaga fans. And who are diehard Gaga fans? Mostly queer people, mostly gay men, you know.
I'd rather be dry, but at least I'm alive. Rain on me.
And when these gay men apply the song to their own lives, the lyrics can pretty easily map onto their experience as growing up queer. The song Bad Kids is about the experience of growing up queer, not because that's the meaning explicit in the text, but because that's how it's experienced by the people who listen to it. For example, look at the lyric. My parents died till they got divorced because I ruined their life. It could just be about a bratty kid, so difficult to raise that they actually caused their parents' divorce. But interestingly, Gaga's parents are still together. So even though she sings that line in the first person, people whose parents separated because of the stress of raising a queer kid who they wished wasn't are able to create more meaning by listening and singing along than even Gaga was able to create when she was writing it. Of course, a different, non-queer person could map their own experiences onto the song, and that interpretation would be just as valid for them, but the gays constitute a majority of Gaga's audience, and she knows that. With that in mind, I propose a new reading of Bad Kids. Those things that she lists in the verses, those can all be read as coping mechanisms or just attitudes adopted by gay people growing up in a homophobic society. A bitch, a jerk, a brat, a selfish punk, you know, hardened by the cruel, cruel world. All of a sudden, the song is not just about loving and accepting people despite the rough edges, it's about celebrating the rough edges as proof that us bad kids survived our systemic oppression. A lot of which, unfortunately, comes from organized religion. She sings in the pre-chorus. This reading of the song that includes an understanding of systemic injustice can be applied to the experiences of other oppressed people, along the lines of race or gender, for example. But like I said, what this song means in a pop culture sense is heavily influenced by the people who are listening to it. Or, as David Brown says in God of Grace and Body, increasingly, those who study the aesthetics of pop culture are urging that the focus should be not on the structure of the music, but on the totality of its reception by the listener. And the listeners are gay, so the song is too. I also think it's interesting how Gaga moves between first and second person in the song, moving freely from I'm a bad kid to you're a bad kid. By doing this, she positions herself as one of us. But in other songs, she recognizes, despite her similarity, she's still the one on stage, and we're still the ones in the audience. For example, track 12. Gaga does interesting things with point of view in this song as well. Most of it's in third person and first person plural, but also other parts of it are in second person, and even other parts are in first person singular. Interestingly, the person she references in the third person is herself, the titular highway unicorn. This highway unicorn is portrayed as a badass leader of the people into freedom, a sort of Moses leading the Israelites out of Egypt figure. Verse 2 paints this picture the clearest. Here we have Gaga positioning, well, not really positioning as much as recognizing herself as a gay icon. She bleeds rainbow syrup, she's a major figure in the fight for LGBTQ acceptance, and she doesn't care if your papers or your love is a law, paralleling the lyrics from Americano. In verse 1, Gaga sings, run, run with the fury of a Satan arise. In comparing herself to a saint here, Gaga is not only emphasizing her passion, but positioning herself as a sort of religious figure. In the Washington Post opinion piece we've already discussed, Guthrie Graves Fitzsimmons calls Gaga a hymn writer. He also calls Gaga a prophet and a pastor in his article, which you know bothered Pastor Gabe.
America and the world will witness not just a pop star, but a prominent Christian take the stage at NRG Stadium on Sunday. This was at the Super Bowl. The prophet and pastor, referring to Lady Gaga, will lead us all in worship. It may not look like your grandparents' church service, but her values do reflect those of Jesus Christ. Nonsense. And now you understand why it's necessary to expose these things as evil and instead preach the truth, that one may walk in the righteousness of Christ, not following after the sinfulness of this woman whom the Washington Post proclaimed to be a preacher of Christ to today's generation. What blasphemy.
Now, I've never been to a Lady Gaga concert. Disaster, I know. But in his article, A Religion Against Itself, Lady Gaga, God and Love, Doctor of Philosophy Peter Klein writes, I remember vividly one of her sermonettes at a particular monster ball I attended in Nashville. With a fiery conviction that would outdo any Southern preacher, she proclaimed to us, Jesus loves every fucking one of you. And I have no doubt that she was aware of the signs being picketed about outside the arena before the show, urging homosexuals and other sinners to repent. Gaga assumed the role of counter-preacher, and she wasn't kidding around. But her sermonette didn't lead into some moralizing or tear-jerking song. It led into a raucous performance of Boys, 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 as if to say the only proper theological response to bigotry and hatred is to dance in its face to the tune of a seemingly vapid pop song. Emphasis on seemingly. The song is fire. Whether people like Pastor Gabe like it or not, Lady Gaga is preaching, and fans are having real religious experiences at her shows. Pastor Gabe might think that by doing this, she's leading us straight to hell, and he has no problem sharing that, but Rena has since taught us what to do about that. The little country dance. God hates us, all right then, buckle up, that's all we're riding. This hell is better with you, we're burning up together, baby, that makes two. Of course, Gaga's Christianity is different from Pastor Gabe's Christianity. And the songs that we've talked about so far, Born This Way, Black Jesus Cross Almond Fashion, Americano, Judas, Bad Kids, and Highway Unicorn, help paint a picture of the type of Christianity that Gaga is preaching. These songs help show us, as Zarissa Holdaway puts it in her article, Idol Worship, The Beatitudes of Lady Gaga, the kind of Christian Gaga sees herself to be. Welcoming, peaceful, political, steeped in God, in favor of the homo stuff, and utterly resistant to the idea that there's any ideological conflict between those last two things. If you ask me, there are a couple of main types of songs on this album. First, the ones we've already talked about, the gay anthems, and second, feminist freedom songs, which also happen to be gay anthems by extension because nobody loves women like gay men love women. The most explicitly feminist song on the album is, of course, track 7. Scheiße, which from German translates roughly to bullshit, is all about Gaga's desire to be able to live her life as a woman without having to deal with all the misogynistic bullshit. She sings about taking what she wants and taking men out, even if that's not what's expected of her by society. She sings about her frustrations that men have historically had a monopoly over defining what love looks like, but I want to focus on the chorus of this song. With the line, I wish that I could dance on a single prayer, Gaga brings her religion into this conversation about women's equality. As Guthrie Graves Fitzsimmons said, He just needs to get an easier name to say. Some conservative Christians reject her as heretical. The dancing alone is enough to damn her. Gaga wishes she could dance on a single prayer. She feels like she's expected to constantly prove that her faith is real. She wishes one prayer were enough for her siblings in Christ to accept her and let her dance. Instead, they see her dancing, they disapprove, and they claim that she's not a real Christian because her fruit is rotten. Remind you of anyone?
And the Bible says you will know them by her fruit. And just as Will had pointed out, the comment that I read earlier, her fruit is rotten.
But what is this rotten fruit he's referring to? Well, in that original 90-second video, he gives three main reasons why we should doubt her claim of faith.
She's hardly ever dressed, she blasphemes God, and her music and videos are raunchy.
Fortunately, he puts little icons on the screen that give us a better idea of what he means when he says these things. Unfortunately, he blurs them out and puts a big censored sticker over them. Fortunately, I can still tell what all of them are. When he says she's hardly ever dressed, he puts a picture of the Art Pop album cover up. To be fair to him, she is naked in that picture, but she's all covered up. When he says she blasphemes God, he puts up a picture that's clearly the Born This Way album cover, but it's weirdly more zoomed in than the standard edition cover, but not as zoomed in as the special edition cover. And also in the top left, there's what appears to be Lady Gaga's name in the font that's found on the Born This Way single cover and posters. I'm not sure where he got this picture. I can't find it anywhere on the internet. Point is, it seems he thinks the song Born This Way is blasphemous against God. We've already talked about his thoughts on that song though, and he definitely doesn't give a good argument that she's blaspheming God. The most he does is point out that they disagree on some tertiary doctrine without providing any evidence for why she's wrong and he's right, besides just scoffing at her.
Different lover is not a sin. Believe, capital H-I-M. Unbelievable.
Finally, when he says her music and videos are raunchy, he puts up a picture of the single for Applause. I don't know why he chose Applause. The music video in some parts is kind of raunchy, I guess, but the song isn't sexual at all. I mean, GUI was right there. He could have chosen that one. I get the single cover is a little less iconic, but I mean, I still would have recognized it. Plus, like, look at the video. You might have noticed that his first and third points are pretty similar. She's hardly ever dressed and her music and videos are raunchy is kind of the same complaint. Ironically, the background of the album cover that Pastor Gabe takes issue with is spliced together images of The Birth of Venus by Botticelli and Apollo and Daphne by Bernini. Both works of art depict non-sexual female nudity. They both got full lady nipple out. The Birth of Venus was commissioned by the Medici family, which was such a prominent family in the Catholic Church that four of them ended up being popes, and Apollo and Daphne was commissioned by a Catholic cardinal. So when Catholic men, commissioned by other Catholic men, create artwork depicting female nudity, that artwork goes down in history as a great achievement. But when Lady Gaga, herself a Catholic, participates in that tradition, she is condemned as not a real Christian, as evidenced by her rotten fruit. You could argue that the difference is that the classical art depicts non-sexual nudity while Gaga's art is sexual. But do you really think most of Gaga's art is intended to cause sexual arousal? Need I remind you who her audience is?
I'd rather be dry, but at least I'm alive. Rain on me.
But no. Botticelli's Birth of Venus, high art. Lady Gaga dressed up as Botticelli's Birth of Venus, unacceptable. And Gaga's tired of that. She's saying there's no need to question a woman's faith just because she dances sexily. In other words, the New Jesus movement that Gaga describes in Black Jesus Cross Amen fashion doesn't condemn women for being sexual beings. I think Gaga as an overtly sexual woman is most explored in track 13. Now, I love every song on this album, but something about the production and vocals on this track awakens something feral within me. I think it's my favorite track on the album. The lyrics depict Gaga as a woman in charge who knows what she wants. She even suggests what seems to be a game of strip poker, but could be something more. In the bridge of the song, she even refers to drunken sex with her lover as a sort of baptism. Christianity has a long history of discouraging women's sexuality, even in the context of marriage. Even today, young Christian couples waiting for marriage to have sex are often told that men always have a naturally higher sex drive, that men always want sex more than women, and that women should give themselves up to their husband whenever he wants them. This does a couple things. One, it leads to women having less pleasurable sex because they've been taught that it isn't really meant to be pleasurable for them. It's more meant to be a gift that they give to their husband. And second, it leaves couples in which the woman has a higher sex drive than the man, leaving confused and broken. Bringing Heavy Metal Lover and this issue within modern evangelical Christianity into conversation can teach us that sex is supposed to be pleasurable for women, so much so that it's comparable to a baptism. But what's most interesting to me about this song is its placement within the album, right before track 14. If you want me, need me at Electric Chapel. First, this song seems like a total counterpoint to the one that came before it. In the first verse, she describes her body in religious terms. In the pre-chorus, she sings, it's not about sex or champagne, you call it boom. Which all builds up to the chorus. Wanna steal my heart away. Meet me, baby, in a safe place. The message of the song is best summarized, I think, by a line in the second pre-chorus. Together we'll both find a way to make your love work in a dirty way. She wants sex, but she wants to get to know the man first. And she wants to get to know him at the Electric Chapel. At a chapel because her faith is important to her, but it's electric because she still wants that excitement. She doesn't want to be lectured at this chapel about the low sex drive of women or why women should give themselves up to their man whenever he wants them. The line, together we'll both find a way, hints at a supremely egalitarian view of consent that's distorted by some churches. Last overtly sexual track that I haven't really talked about yet is track 3. I don't really have much to say about this track. To be honest, I think it's probably my least favorite. Don't kill me. Don't get it twisted, guys. I like all the songs, but you gotta have a least favorite, you know? It's not a skip or anything. Stop. The one thing that I do want to draw attention to is the outro, which is obviously explicit, but also censored. And it's not the only album in the song that is self-censored. She censors herself in Bad Kids. I'm ever- and again in a song called The Queen. Despite rumors, an uncensored version of the album was never released. There are a couple theories about why she might have done this, the main one being, without the parental advisory explicit content sticker on the album, she would be able to sell more units. Gotta make that money. The cynic might say, typical of a pop star to censor themselves for fame and money. And like, yeah, Gaga didn't write the fame or money, honey, for no reason. But as David Brown says in his book, God of Grace and Body, Sacrament and Ordinary, commercialization has always been an element in the production of music. Even Beethoven modified initial versions of particular works in order to make them more marketable. Another part of the Born This Way rollout cycle that's worth mentioning here is the 99 cent Amazon deal. During the first week of its release, Gaga was selling the whole album on the Amazon MP3 store for just 99 cents. I know it's hard to imagine now in the age of streaming, but back in 2011, when Spotify was only like 3 years old, people still bought the music they listened to. The album did amazingly well, selling over a million copies in the first week. It's hard to compare Lady Gaga's popularity between albums because the way that we listen to music has changed so drastically over the course of her career. But Born This Way is easily one of her best performing albums, and it being clean, and in some cases 99 cents, certainly didn't hurt. But if keeping the album clean tells us that she wanted to move a lot of copies, selling the album for only 99 cents tells us that maybe profit wasn't her main motivator. What was her motivation then? Did she just want to make sure she hit number one on the Billboard 200? Because even without those Amazon sales, she still would have debuted at number one, beating out Brad Paisley's This Is Country Music, which debuted that week at number two by nearly 500,000 units. Again, that's if we're not counting the 99 cent sales through Amazon. Of course, the sale was mutually beneficial for Amazon and Gaga. Gaga wanted an album that sold a lot of units, and Amazon wanted more people using their digital music store. With all this in mind, along with her saying during her 73 question interview with Vogue that she most wants to be remembered for the message behind Born This Way.
What would you like to be remembered for?
I would like to be remembered for the message behind Born This Way.
It seems Gaga just wanted as many people to listen to the album as possible because she really believed in its message. The message of sexual liberation from religious expectations isn't the only feminist message found in Born This Way, though. Preserving women's right to express their womanhood within a more conventional religious framework is important to her, too, as she expresses in track 16. You and I is a love song written to Gaga's Nebraska guy. Unlike most of the album, which is inspired by New York, where she grew up, You and I's lyrics and aesthetic more closely resemble the conservative Midwest.
It's been a long time since I came around. Been a long time, but I'm back in town.
This all culminates in the bridge.
We got a whole lot of money, but we still pay rent. 'Cause you can't buy a house in heaven.
I love this line because on the one hand, it's Gaga calling her relationship with this person heaven. She and the Nebraska guy can't buy a house because when they're together, they're in heaven, and you can't buy a house in heaven. But it's also a descriptive statement about how Gaga views the afterlife. She knows her money won't matter there. The bridge continues.
There's only three men that I'ma serve my whole life. It's my daddy and Nebraska and Jesus Christ. Yes.
At first glance, it might seem like this is the exact opposite of Heavy Metal Lover. On that track, Gaga was in charge, but now she's giving up her power to men as dictated by social and cultural traditions in a way that you might expect a self-proclaimed feminist like Gaga to be against. But there's an important word doing a lot of work here. Only. There's only three men that I'ma serve my whole life. She feels no sense of obligation to men in general, but there are three specific men that it seems she's proud to serve. Her father, perhaps because she respects him and feels indebted to him as a parent for raising her. Jesus Christ, because serving him is part of her religious convictions and her faith. But what about Nebraska? Is a woman committing to serve her male partner like this an inherently anti-feminist act because it plays into the historical expectation that relationships be patriarchal? I don't think so. First, because the relationship dynamic Gaga describes in the song doesn't necessarily have to be patriarchal. It's possible that Gaga serves Nebraska and Nebraska serves Gaga in like a mutual egalitarian servitude. But even if Gaga wanted to enter into a relationship that adheres to traditional gender roles, it would still be a feminist act as long as Gaga chooses it for herself. Some women just want to be trad wives. They were born this way. It's an issue when a structural power convinces young women that entering into this type of relationship is the only good option for everyone, of course, but it's clear that Gaga really wants this relationship. She isn't being coerced into it. And this isn't the only song in the album that's about Lady Gaga being born for a man. Let's take a look at another love song. Track 11. Fashion of His Love is all about Gaga finding a relationship that she feels like is perfect for her. This relationship fits her like a well-tailored dress. But when Gaga reaches the chorus, she sings, she's receiving signs from God that this relationship is the one that she's meant to be in. But the rest of the chorus is what really stood out to me. This is interesting to me because in the history of the Christian church, whenever the question, why did God make man, is asked, the answer is almost always something along the lines of, we were made for loving him. As the current Catechism of the Catholic Church puts it, the desire for God is written on the human heart because man is created by God and for God, and God never ceases to draw man to himself. Or as the Westminster Shorter Catechism, which I was taught, puts it, what is the chief end of man? Man's chief end is to glorify God and enjoy him forever. This is such an important issue that it's literally the first question in the Westminster Shorter Catechism, and it's also the first thing addressed in the main text of the Catechism of the Catholic Church. That the line, I was made for loving him, the fashion of his love, sounds like it could be about God, is probably not a coincidence. Comparing God's love for humanity to human relationships is a proud tradition in the Christian church. Paul did it all the way back in Romans 5. Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. I think the rest of the song is a bit too romantic and sexual for it to be read as exclusively about God. But I think understanding the layer of God in this song is important to understanding the second half of the bridge. Everyone else in her life has an opinion about her relationship, but she feels strong enough to know how she feels for him, without considering everybody else's opinion. This also mirrors her relationship with God. Everybody, Pastor Gabe and myself included, has an opinion about her relationship with God, but she knows her own faith more than anyone else ever could. No longer raising a fire to justify how I feel for you, my love. She doesn't need to cry about what other people think about her faith. She doesn't need to justify her faith either. Gaga knows that Pastor Gabe's opinions about her faith don't affect her relationship with God at all. Obviously, Lady Gaga doesn't know who Pastor Gabe is, but like, this is an example. Okay, there are a few songs that I haven't talked about yet because I don't really have much to say about them, but I already made all those cool, like, song transitions, and I want to use them all. So let's just speed run through them. Let's talk about track 6. To me, this song is kind of reminiscent of the story of Samson found in the Book of Judges, specifically the line, "And if I'm hot, shot, mom will cut my hair at night. In the morning, I'm short of my identity." This one does feel like a bit of a stretch to me, but considering all the religious imagery throughout the rest of the album, I wouldn't be surprised if it was also intentional. Let's talk about track 15. I already mentioned this track is one of the ones that Gaga self-censored. Other than that, it's mostly just another feminist freedom song that deals with the issues I already talked about in You and I. She's doing things for her lover, not because she's weak and subservient, but because she's strong enough to choose that for herself. I think the song can also be read, similar to Highway Unicorn, as a love song to her fans. She can be the queen her little monsters need her to be. Next up, track 1. The only thing I can really think to say about this song is that in the second verse, she sings, "Down the street that I love, and my fishnet gloves, I'm a sinner." Initially, I was going to play that clip right after a clip of Pastor Gabe saying that the difference between a saved person and an unsaved person is that the saved person knows they're a sinner, and the unsaved person doesn't think they're doing anything wrong. But I realized that that would be a cheap gotcha that kind of misses the point that Pastor Gabe was trying to make. I guess it made it into the video anyways, though. Up next, track 17. Where we can both fall her in love. I'm on the edge of glory, and I'm hanging on to you. Like the opening track, I don't have much to say about the closing track, Edge of Glory, either. Roberts discusses this song in his essay in terms of the liminal, in a way that I thought was really interesting, but I don't really have much to add to. So you can just go read that for yourself if you can find a copy free online, or you can find it through an institution or a library like I did, or you can pay like $35 for it. I don't know why they always paywall academic work behind, like, it's so expensive. It's like a 25-page article. That's more than a dollar a page. What's going on? In 2011, you could buy the full album Born This Way for cheaper than you can buy one page of this essay. Anyways, that's the album. Unless, I feel like there was one more song I was supposed to talk about. Like I said earlier, Bloody Mary is a love song written to Jesus from the perspective of Mary Magdalene. And despite every attempt to understand this song as a commentary on Jesus or religion, I've come to realize that more than anything, this is a song about Mary Magdalene herself. As I mentioned in the beginning of the video, the only thing that Roberts writes about this song is, "Bloody Mary is hard to interpret, but her typically strange confession of belief that Mary Magdalene was both fully divine and fully human suggests a transgression of the dominant theological tradition of Christianity." He's referring here to something Gaga said in an interview with NME before the album came out. She said, "I believe that Mary Magdalene was both fully divine and fully human. She has to be strong when Jesus fulfills the prophecy to die for everyone's sins, but she still has the moment of humanity where she's upset to let him go. She has to be a superstar, but she must have cried too. I've never heard this in Mary Magdalene Fully Divine Theory before, and my immediate reaction is to disagree. Jesus is the only being that is both fully human and fully divine. That's why he was the one who had to be crucified. But instead of immediate rejection, I'm going to try and understand Gaga on her own terms before bringing that into conversation with the standard belief of the Christian tradition. She doesn't say anything else about Mary Magdalene in this interview, but elsewhere, when discussing her prayer life, she said as a child she always prayed to women because she didn't view God as having any particular gender. I was raised Protestant, and I've always thought that the Catholic practice of praying to saints and other historical religious figures who aren't God was a bit weird, but I've never considered the fact that this practice allows for the feminist act of praying to women. For another example of the importance of women in her faith, in the Chromatica interview with Zane Lowe, Gaga says that she believes that a feminine sine wave was the initial cause of the universe.
I know you know, like, I do believe in God. I don't believe in God the way that, you know, maybe through art throughout history it's been portrayed. But I believe in a higher force, and I used to talk to Blood Pop about it. There's a theory that the whole world was created by a feminine sound wave.
What's interesting about this claim is just how compatible it is with the biblical creation story. In Genesis, God speaks the world into existence. God creates sound, and that is the cause of the universe. Who's to say that it wasn't a feminine voice that made that sound?
But that my understanding of God actually is that it's a sign. I believe God began as a sound.
So it's clear that the feminine is a very important part of Gaga's faith. It seems to me that this is probably why she believes that Mary Magdalene was fully human and fully divine like Jesus. The historical Mary Magdalene was probably Jesus's most prominent female follower. Since Gaga believes in the power of the feminine in her religion, it seems she believes that Mary Magdalene is a more important character in the Christian story than the Christian religious tradition has led us to believe. Like the statements of egalitarian power found throughout the album, it seems like Gaga wants to believe that a man isn't the only fully divine human character in the story, that God sent a fully divine woman to Earth, too. Wait until the NBs hear about this. Only a man and a woman? Not God participating in non-binary erasure. In the end, I don't agree with Lady Gaga in this particular theological point, but considering it fully has helped broaden my understanding of the importance of the feminine in the Christian religion. And that is how I now understand this song, as a statement that Mary is just as important a character as Jesus, Judas, or Peter. In the end, I think this song provides me with the best argument for why we should take Lady Gaga seriously as a theological voice. Because her instinct that Mary Magdalene might be more important to the Christian story than the religious tradition has let on might be even truer than we thought. For just a second, let's turn our attention to a different pop album that came out in 2011, Magdalene by Libby Schrader. The title track includes this lyric.
There's a picture hanging by the bedroom door. It's a vision of Our Lady. Maybe virgin, maybe whore.
I'm not actually going to talk about the album or the song, I just thought that lyric was fun. What's more interesting to me is that while writing it, Elizabeth Schrader made a discovery that sent her away from music and down a path of scholarship. This eventually led to the publication of her article, Was Martha of Bethany Added to the Fourth Gospel in the Second Century? The main focus of her research is on the early sections of John 11, which in my Bible reads, Now a man named Lazarus was sick. He was from Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. This Mary, whose brother Lazarus now lay sick, was the same one who poured perfume on the Lord and wiped his feet with her hair. So the sisters sent word to Jesus. While studying the oldest available manuscript of the Book of John, called Papyrus 66, Schrader found evidence that this Martha character may not have been in the story at all. At first, I could explain this to you and like read quotes from the article, but I found a good Zoom lecture she gave on YouTube. So I'm just going to let her explain it in her own words.
So the scribe originally wrote, there was a certain sick man, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary, and of Mary, his sister. Even though the scribe does occasionally make didactic errors, that's where the scribe accidentally writes the same thing twice. That's what people who had looked at this before me assumed was happening. It should be noted that it's not just a dactography. It's not just that the name Mary is written twice. Maria, so this looks like an M, right? Ma, this looks like a P, but it's actually a Rho. Marias, that's like the genitive, like of Mary. Maria and Maria. You can see that this was an iota, M-A-R-I-A, and the iota has been changed to a theta. Iota is changed, and in Greek, the theta is like a th. So the name Maria has been changed to Martha. It's not just that, it's also that it originally said Mary, his sister, and it's changed to say Martha, her sister. So by way of correction, Martha is added to John 11, verse 1. And again, this is the world's oldest copy of John 11. But then the woman is split in two by means of three things. First of all, the singular apostelen, which means sent. It's changed to the plural. So it's a singular verb that's changed to a plural verb. She sent is changed to they sent. As you can see, the woman's name has been very awkwardly scratched out, and just squished in are now the words hi Adelphi, the sisters. It was originally saying, therefore Maria sent to him saying, and then it was made plural by making the verbs plural and changing the woman's name. So she had a name, the name has been erased, and she's been split into two. There's now two unnamed women, hi Adelphi, the sisters. So this is interesting. Is there one sister or two in John 11, verse 3 that sends the message to Jesus? You can see that the oldest copy seems uncertain as to whether there's one sister or two in John 11, verse 3. And even the King James Bible is uncertain as to whether there's one sister or two. The first printing has one sister, the second printing has two sisters. So the order of names is different. Who is named is different. And you can also see here that a corrector, this is probably hundreds of years later. This is an uncial script from about the 5th century. This is a Carolingian minuscule from about 300 to 400 years later. You can see that a later corrector noticed that Martha's name is missing from the verse, and so has added Martha's name into the margin. So now it says Jesus loved Lazarus and Mary and Martha, her sister. Okay? Well, notice that Mary and Martha make an identical statement. Lord, if you'd been here, my brother would not have died. It's because of that identical statement that a lot of redaction critics before me, without even looking at the manuscript transmission, had thought that maybe something was doubled here. Maybe there was originally just one sister. So some people we know thought that Lazarus's sister Mary was Mary Magdalene. We know as far back as interpretation goes, people did think that. Not everyone, but enough people did that it was sort of a common interpretation. So why would you add Martha to this story of John 11? I think that it might have something to do with this Christological confession, which is in John 11, verse 27. Right now it's Martha who says to Jesus, Lord, if you'd been here, my brother would not have died. And Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live, and everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? Everybody knows that quote, right? That's one of Jesus's most famous statements in the Gospels, but people forget who he's talking to. Who is Jesus talking to when he says that? She says, yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, the one coming into the world. People know that quote too, but again, they forget who said it in John's Gospel. Tertullian, who wrote in about 210 AD, Tertullian, every copy of Against Praxeas says that Mary gave the Christological confession. So Tertullian's writing around 210 AD. Maybe he has a copy of John's Gospel where Martha isn't there and Mary's giving the confession. So why would somebody add Martha? Maybe it's to make sure that Mary is not the one giving the confession. Because if she's understood to be Mary Magdalene, which some people did, then she's giving a Christological confession that Jesus is the Christ. Then she immediately anoints him, which is something you might do if you thought someone was the Christ, you might anoint them. Then she's at the cross. She does not abandon Jesus at the cross. She's at the empty tomb. She's the only person in the empty tomb. This is in John's Gospel, right? She's the only one who goes to the empty tomb. She's the first person that the risen Jesus appears to. And then she gets the first apostolic commission. So this confession of Jesus as the Christ, if Mary gives it, then it's tied together with this first resurrection appearance of Jesus in this narrative way throughout John's gospel. And it makes Mary a central character in John's gospel, which is very similar to the way that Peter is portrayed in Matthew's gospel. Remember who gives the Christological confession in Matthew's gospel. Jesus says, "Who do you say that I am?" And Peter answers, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God," which is the equivalent confession in Matthew. So Peter gets a huge reward in Matthew's gospel for being the Christological confessor. We actually know from texts like the Gospel of Thomas, the Gospel of Mary, the Gospel of Philip, the Pista Sophia, that there was something controversial about Mary Magdalene, that some second and third century communities understood her as being attacked by Peter and whoever Peter represented. Since we know that those debates were happening in the second and the third centuries, which is around the time that I'm suggesting these editorial things took place, it's possible that Mary was seen as sort of a threatening figure. If Peter is the one who is the rock that the church is built on, and Peter gives the confession, and then, you know, and it makes Peter a central character in Matthew's gospel, but they don't want Mary Magdalene to have that same sort of prominence in John's gospel. So the solution is just to import Martha from Luke's gospel. People were reading Luke's gospel by the second century, the second and third centuries. So I'm saying that just by changing an iota to a theta, you can change the name Mary to Martha, and then you have a non-threatening character saying, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, the one coming into the world."
I just think this is so interesting, and if Bloody Mary by Lady Gaga is an assertion of the importance of Mary Magdalene and the feminine in the Christian story, then Schrader's research is evidence supporting that claim. I hope that everything we've explored in this video today has convinced you that Lady Gaga is an important theological voice, and we should take her seriously. And we've only really talked about one album today. There's so much more in her discography to dissect and discuss. Maybe we'll come back to it another day. Subscribe so you don't miss it. For now, let's close in prayer.
So please help me to be strong, and please help me to know my own strength. Please help me to be brave, Lord. Dear God, give me courage. Do not let me give in to those feelings. Do not let me give in to my own insecurities. Allow me to walk in your light. Allow me to live and breathe and sing and dance for all the dancers on that stage, for the band, for the music, and for you. Amen.
Amen.
Now I got some shit to do.
My mama told me when I was young, we are all born superstars. There's nothing wrong with loving who you are. She said, 'cause he made you perfect, babe. I'm beautiful in my way, 'cause God makes no mistakes. I'm on the right track, baby. I was born this way. Don't hide yourself in regret. Just love yourself and your set. I'm on the right track, baby. I was born this way. Give yourself prudence and love your friends so we can rejoice in your truth. In the religion of the insecure, I must be myself. Respect my youth. A different lover is not a sin. Believe, capital H-I-M. No matter gay, straight, or bi, lesbian, transgender, light, I'm on the right track, baby. I was born to survive.